And good morning. This is Far North Tactical's Saturday morning wake-up call right here on KFAR Local Talk Radio, where for the next hour or so we are going to be talking about liberty and the issues that are congruent with it. Joining me in the studio, we've got Josh Bennett from Far North Tactical and the person who pays for the program here, Aaron Bennett. Did I say that Josh Bennett was from Far North?
Good morning, Steve.
I buy a lot of stuff there.
I think we all buy a lot of stuff there, or we should, one way or the other.
Aren't we going there after this, Josh, to get you some new guns?
I mean, yes. I understand that you can actually get everything you need for the zombie apocalypse over there. Is that right?
I don't have any zombie-proof underwear, but other than that.
All right, well, gentlemen.
Everything but...
No, by the way, I'm Steve Floyd. I'm just the monkey behind the machine here. I'm just making sure that you guys get on the air with your show. So, where do we go from here?
Aaron, where are you going?
Where am I going?
Three, two.
You didn't have anything this morning? You told me you
Wow.
did. Come on.
All I want to do is rant about the government, so you guys are good with that. I'm good with that. The down with the presidency. I've been listening to... we can talk about a few of the things in the news, like the Joker, Obama talking, you know, his little rant about... If you got a business, you didn't get that yourself. The government gave it to you. Basically, anything that you've done, the government has done for you. And I thought about that, and I read somebody... forget who it was that I read, but he said that basically he was probably talking about his own life because he probably has nothing that the government has not given him. But maybe that's all he knows, that there is no other way but by government.
Well, you'd have other people argue that it's not possible to have anything that the government didn't give you. I mean, one way or another,
well,
every dollar that you have has passed through government hands at one point, right?
Yeah.
But I don't think that's what he was trying to say at all, personally, but...
No, he was telling us that we need... Well, basically, he was saying that businesses, people that make money, need to be paying more of their fair share because they wouldn't have what they have gotten without the government, which is pretty interesting because I look at it that if it wasn't for the government, I would have a lot more. Government hasn't... I mean, if I look at cost analysis on there, they steal a lot more of my property than what I get back from them. And every day, see, I would say that when I was a kid, I could look at what my dad had to pay in taxes and the service that he got to now. I can see what our tax rate is. I mean, I know I pay probably, my company probably pays somewhere around 60% after they pay employees and all the regulation taxes and income taxes and business taxes and fuel taxes. It's probably around 60%. So in the last, since I've been alive, I can look at what my dad paid, which I don't even remember what he was or if he paid anything for that matter. But I can look at the service that he got compared to the service I get now from the government and what I have to pay for it. So basically my service has gone down dramatically, but my price has gone up. And I have no choice in it. I can't go to a competitor and say, you know what? This government sucks. And they're charging me too much and not giving me squat. I've been robbed several times. They show up after the fact. They never caught the guy that robbed me. I mean, I've been robbed how many times? Let's see. They try to throw me in jail when I caught the guy that robbed me one time instead of the actual thief. So I think that I'm getting stolen from instead of actually paying for a commodity. So,
and what is government other than a service?
Well, they would say that they're a service, but what service do they give you for the price that you pay? 60% of my wealth is stolen from them, and they decide what to give back in return.
See, now you're looking at it, both of you are looking at it entirely the wrong way here. It's not about you getting anything from the government. It's what you can give to the government. It is your patriotic duty.
Right.
Ask not what your country can do for you.
If you get right down to the brass tacks of what Josh is saying, if you really think about it, that's all government is a service, right?
Right.
So why would you do anything for your service? if I go hire a street sweeper, do I go sweep the street for him?
No.
That doesn't even make any sense.
So, and the biggest problem with it is that we have no choice in the matter. We don't have a competitor that we can go to and say, yeah, these guys suck, so I want to hire you to be my defense, my bodyguard, take care of my property, sweep my streets, do whatever. I don't have that choice. I have a government, which, who is or what is government? We still have, I don't think we can figure that out, because it's really an illusion. There's no point, there's nothing you can go to and say, government. And this, there's a guy standing there that is government. It's this non-entity with a bunch of people that work inside of it that have the use of all the facilities, but don't actually own it, because it's the people's, because we're the government. And yet, if you go over and jump in the borough pickup over there to borrow it to go on a fishing trip, you'll land your butt in jail. So it's not really yours.
Here's the greatest part. Like, I mean, right down the same line of thinking, you have Obama say that we didn't get anything ourselves. Obviously, government, along the way, government helped us out every step of the way, right?
Uh-huh.
And how is that even possible when government doesn't produce anything? Isn't it only possible for the person, the individual, to give to government, not the other way around?
Bang.
It's not even possible.
Government's a non-producer. It's a non-producer.
I'm going to go throw up. I'll be right back.
All it does is it's expropriates from you, steals from you, your property, and gives basically nothing in return. I cannot, I know people would call in and argue, but cost analysis, I'd be a lot better off having something much different, like no government.
Think about it historically, though. I mean, if you look back at the time when we had nobles that, quote, ran the country or ran Britain for us. If you look at the way that the nobles are, basically the entire reason for their existence is to take from the peasants. They manage the asset, which is the peasants, who are the ones that are producing, and then they take from the peasants in order to go out and buy their armies or whatever materials they need to wage war. But the nobles were the ones that basically just took from the peasants and did with the peasants' money whatever the nobles wanted to. How has that changed?
What's changed is that they only took about 3-8% of... I mean, we love to watch Robin Hood and King John, you know, ripping people off. And he did. But that was about a 3-8% expropriation from the people. It wasn't 60%. The kings and nobles knew that as long the more wealth that their subjects had, the more wealth they had, because they owned everything, right? They claimed ownership to all the land, all the produce, all the people. They claimed ownership to it. So the wealthier, the more wealth that they produced, theoretically, the more wealth he had, the more wealth he could go take. But the more wealth he did steal, the less production there was. I mean, we see that in America, right? We steal so much money from everyone, the government does, that we have about 40-60% of the population that are non-producers, period. So why produce? Because I'm going to get it taken from, and I can get it for free anyway. So you had the king, the nobles, the princes, the monarchical rules. They didn't steal quite so much. If they took too much, then the people would get their pitchforks, go up there, and stab them in the butt.
Yeah, let me interject really quick. I think you hit it on the head earlier when you were saying, what is government? You can't even put your thumb on it. And culminated there with getting your pitchfork. I think that's part of the problem is in free entry into government like we have here, where everyone can be part of the government, you're not able to look to any one thing. You're not able to have any entity that you can focus on as your oppression. And because you can legitimize it by saying, hey, we can just get our guy in, or you yourself can become part of that, then you legitimize everything that government is, right? So how are they able to expropriate 60% of our income? Because you can't even decide who it is that's doing it, right? So if you had a prince or a monarch or something like that, you know directly where the oppression is coming from. So if you have 100,000 subjects that can all focus their energy and anger on one entity, that's pretty easy. How do you do that in America?
You don't.
We do it to ourselves, though. Look at how many bonds get passed.
We vote.
Shall we vote ourselves a tax?
I understand. It's like the sidewalks. Nobody wants the sidewalks, but they get shoved down their throat anyway, right?
Yeah. Apparently.
But who do you even complain to? Where do you go with that?
But they're free sidewalks. It's $450,000 of free money.
That was expropriated from someone else.
I'd like to have that contract.
Our problem is here that it's always stolen money. Nothing's generated from the state.
Right, they have to steal it. It's always been stolen money, right?
Right, as long as there's a state, a monarch, a republic, a democracy. And you look at democracies. You know, I was reading, we were talking about taxes and the princes and stuff, or barons, how much money they took. They also had very little debt, and there weren't price controls. Yeah, they tried price controls, but those always failed miserably. The prices were always lower. If you look in history, like in England, in 1760 England compared to 1860 England, everyday prices were lower in 1860 than they were in 1760, which is pretty amazing. Once we came in after World War I, we decided monarchs suck. We don't want a king ruling over us. We're going to rule ourselves. Well, we're going to put people in charge to rule over us, but we can get in there and tax our neighbor. World debt is at, it's not even comprehensible. There's so much debt. We have 15, 16. I just saw yesterday that we're looking at another $1.2 trillion deficit. We're at an uncontrollable amount of debt, and it's all happened within the last 100 years. It was piddly debt before, and it was always a war debt before. That's another difference too, is that it was always, whenever we went into debt, it's because we decided we want to go kill someone. So we got in a war and we raised a bunch of money and we borrowed a bunch of money and we got into debt, and then they tried to pay it down. But usually before World War I, but it always got paid down a little bit. It was controllable or maintainable or whatever. But since we've seen nothing but this pure socialist democracy, our debts have gone unreal. More money's been stolen from the citizens, the serfs, than kings ever. I mean, if a king could have what the United States president has now, boy, oh boy. Well, first of all, he'd be overthrown. But
right, because you'd be able to focus your energy.
Right. We have a debt. We have higher taxes. We have higher prices. I mean, we all know you can't. I mean, whatever happened to penny candy?
I mean,
now our dollar's worth 1 cent of 1913 dollar. One penny. And that's all thanks to democracy. All of it is thanks to a republic democracy. Democratic Republic, whatever you want to call it.
One of my favorite things to say to people when they start complaining about the president, this and that, did this and that, the first thing that comes out of my mouth usually is, wait a minute, Congress makes laws, right?
Mm-hmm.
How do you even zero in on that concept of who's stealing from you?
And it's not even Congress making the law that's the problem. It's the fact that we obey them. And the fact that we vote in more... that we obey the laws. And why do we obey the law? Because the only reason that we do, even when we know it violates our right, we know that it's stealing from our property. It's actually forcing us to participate in something we might find immoral or disgusting. I mean, Jefferson, I read something in a Newsminer blog that said, oh, well, you just can't pick and choose, you know, what you want to pay for and what you don't want to pay for just because you decide it's immoral. But Jefferson, the guy that wrote the Declaration of Independence, who should be a guide somewhat, at least, if anything, look back and say, well, what did the guy that helped start this stupid country say? He said, to be forced to pay a tax for something that you find immoral is sinful.
I think the main reason why we obey, though, is because we don't want to be put in a cage, Josh.
The main reason we obey is because we can be that government.
Yeah, I agree with Josh. I don't think it's so much about being in a cage. You see people rising up all through history, and it's not the fear of the cage. It's the concept of participatory government where anybody can get in. I mean, if you and I are running against each other, and you get into office and force your will on everybody, but I ran against you, how can I have anything bad to say about you other than that you're just a not a very good guy.
You beat him. But you participated in the process. So you right. have I mean, to bow your knee.
I totally get what Josh says. If I vote for Mitt Romney and Obama wins, then how can I complain about anything that Obama does?
Yeah, you just shot the craps, and you lost. So, play the game out. You lost the game, right. Now you get to obey
it. It's absolutely no different than I took my girlfriend down the other day for the first time to play Rippies. And I don't really even play games like that, but we went and bought $50 worth of Rippies, and we ripped them all, and won a couple small amounts, and then played those off, and we walked away with no money at all. And she said, well, that's not a very good game. But what if we had hit one of the 400s? She would have said, oh, I love that game. That is, let's go do this every weekend, right?
Right, but you didn't crawl over the counter and beat the crap out of the guy that sold you the deal.
I was getting to that.
Oh, but yeah, I guess I should have asked you if I did before.
Now, did you have anybody threatening to put you in a cage if you didn't go and play Rippies?
Now, that's the amazing thing. We did it of our own free will.
Are you serious?
Yeah, but that's not the point I was getting at. The point I was getting at is when I lost, we packed up, we went and got in the truck, and we left. And I never complained about the fact that we didn't win.
Because you played the game.
Because I played the game.
You knew the risk.
Isn't part of the issue, though, here is that there are men with guns that will force you to play the game to a certain degree?
Yeah, they won't necessarily force you to vote, participate in that matter. But, of course, there is the underlying problem of getting shot in the head if you don't play the game as in obey.
Which I think is interesting, the way Josh laid it out. You have basically buildings that people go and occupy, but they're not government in and of themselves. If you ask anybody if they are government, no one will say yes. Except for maybe Obama, I don't know.
No, they say, I work for the state.
Right.
I work for the... Well, who is...
I work for the FBI. No one is that actual entity. But they will, like you said, if you go get in their pickup that's supposedly owned by the people and you try and drive it, they will put you in prison.
Right. So who is the state?
An entity that gets injured a lot. I know that.
Yeah, that's another thing, too, when you look at a state government. When you have a difference with state government versus... non-political action versus between people. When you harm another person, you should pay restitution or whatever. But the state doesn't really get all... I mean, what do they get upset at? Do they get upset if I go over and beat the crap out of Aaron? Probably not. Maybe a little bit.
I don't think anyone would get mad about that.
Maybe a little bit. I might go to jail for a couple days or whatever, you know. Slap on the wrist, get out, whatever. Try go punching any state employee in the face. Go punch a cop. Don't do that. I'm just saying,
What if you threatened?
What if you happened to
violent
possibly...
Violent action against a state official.
In a defensive form. You go to jail forever. You could go to jail forever. Years and years and years.
So you can make a plan to defend yourself against an alien team of Martians from, say, I don't know, Colorado, and maybe even get life in prison.
Yeah. So this entity that doesn't exist, that people work for, but they don't know who it is, they say it's us, but we'll get thrown in jail if we use, like if I go borrow a grader to trim up my road a little bit, bang, I either get thrown in jail or shot. I mean, if you resist, then you get dead. Where was I going with that? Jeremiah, quit texting me. Gosh. He just threw me off. So we go from... to an entity that steals 60% of your wealth, that doesn't even protect you and will not force you to compensate a person that you violate. You have to compensate the state, that is so into itself, even though it doesn't exist. If you violate one of its members, you go to jail forever. And the biggest thing that I think is wonderful that I try to convince people is that this entity that doesn't exist, that people work for, that steals 60% of your profit, or actually percent of your property, it also is an entity, which doesn't exist, that claims to own your life. And it claims to own your life, whereas if I go park in the wrong spot out here and I get this little $25 ticket or $70, you've probably got a lot of them, Aaron. How much are they?
I think they're like $50, and yes, I have gotten a few.
So you get a $50 parking ticket. They claim with that $50 ticket, they can kill you over that. They can shoot you in the head. If you take it to the point where you say, I'm not going to pay that, well, then you'll get another fine or a summons to appear, and then if you don't do that, then eventually, ultimately,
let me clarify for people that grew up in Alaska. It's a little different for Alaskans for one reason only. It's because we have something they call the permanent fund dividend. So, for something as minor as a parking ticket or like a headlight out ticket or something like that, and you're a no-show into court, that'll get put into the system and get levied against your permanent fund dividend. And that's pretty cool for people that live in Alaska, but if you live in any other state, Josh is absolutely right. If I get a parking ticket and I don't pay it, there's a warrant put out for my arrest. And if I resist that arrest, then yes, I mean, ultimately you could get killed over a parking ticket. Not going to happen in Alaska because just for one reason only, they have a way to expropriate money out of you.
They'll take your dividend. Well, they'll still kill you, though, because, I mean, if you don't... If you get a parking if you get a speeding ticket and you don't pay it, they might take that money, but they'll also throw you in jail.
Well, I was only talking about minor infractions. Stuff like parking tickets and stuff like that, because I just wanted to clarify, because people could, I don't want anybody calling up saying, I got a parking ticket and I didn't pay it and nobody came after me. Mm-hmm. It's the only reason is because they still have a way to get restitution for themselves for the ticket they levied on you.
The question I have in all of this is what... How is this any different than the existence of people 300, 400, 1,000 years ago under whatever form of government they had? It has always been the same, hasn't it? Regardless of who thinks they're in charge?
To a lesser extent.
To a lesser extent. And I think we kind of hit on some of the reasons those extents were lesser, but all of it comes down to the participatory government.
And another... The biggest factor right now versus 300 years ago is secession. You could pack your bags and move on. Head west, young man, and you just kept moving. It's the only reason that people, well, there was monopolistic. There was a lot of monopolies going on when we first came to America because the king said, now I own all this land. You can have this if you pay me fealty, blah, blah, blah. But people came to America to escape tyranny. And... They just kept moving west as when the Constitution was forced on everyone and this new central government came up and all of a sudden they started pushing down the throats of people. They just moved west. Move west. You were free. You were free. Now we got nowhere to move.
But they're moving west, didn't they take land that belonged to somebody else? Didn't they move into somebody else's backyard?
Yeah. A lot of times they were just shooting and a killing to take that land too.
That's totally a side issue. Yeah. What Josh is saying, totally.
There's nowhere for us to go now. We're stuck. The only thing we could do, I mean, our first secessionist movement was a revolution, right? We decided to secede from England, and that was successful. And only a third of the people really promoted it. I've heard that a third of the people were for it, a third of the people didn't give a crap, because they were just busy doing their lives, and about a third of the people were Tories that loved the king. But... Some 100 years later, we had another secessionist movement, and stomp. Didn't happen. You are not allowed to secede anymore. And now, since our land's full, you can go move to the Brooks Range somewhere, but they'll come shoot you because you don't actually own it.
If I remember my history right, at the very peak of the Revolutionary War, especially when America wasn't faring so well as far as the revolutionaries go, there was 5,000 Tories fighting for the crown and only 3,000 Patriots fighting for George Washington at the peak of the Revolutionary War, I'm pretty sure.
Wow.
So there was actually, at one point, there was more loyalists fighting than there was anti-loyalists.
Rebels.
Revolutionaries. So basically, we've come to the point, so what do we do? And I don't know that I have...
Voting Mitt Romney.
I don't have an answer. Except for I can personally secede. I can either move to another country that has maybe a smaller government because the people aren't as wealthy, so the government can't steal as much money, so they're not as powerful. I can go hide somewhere down there, you know, in Southern America or something like that. I mean, you can't escape the United States. You can't escape it. You can go live wherever you want, Timbuktu here. There is no more Timbuktus in America. They can find you, and they can kill you. So I guess we can talk about what shall we do then?
You got it on the Saturday morning wake-up call.
Tears were crying.
Not in Nottingham. You got it here on KFAR. It's local talk radio broadcasting around the world at KFAR660.com. And this is the Saturday morning wake-up call, which is a program by Far North Tactical. Joining us in the studio from Far North Tactical, we've got Aaron Bennett, and from one of the co-sponsors or benefactors or whatever you want to call it, we've got Bighorn Enterprises, Josh Bennett. Gentlemen.
Hating on the stick.
Who's gentle?
Yeah, all ooh, four golly, of our lines.
Golly, golly, what a day.
All of our phone lines are on hold.
Let's take them. Do this.
Good morning, caller. This yes. is the Saturday morning wake-up call. Who's there?
Good morning, it's Al.
Al.
Yeah, yeah, you know, this may be a part of your answer to your question of what should we do. It may not be the right one, but just, you know, reviewing history is how did we get to this place? We did it through a participatory process of voting, and it took 200 years to get to where we go. So it may take a 200 more years to get back to where we were by participating in the government.
If you got where we're at by participatory government, how could you get back by the same process?
By changing people's ideology of wanting smaller government.
Right, but you can't...
When has that ever happened before, Al?
It hasn't.
Right, so we vote people in that...
So I had the disclaimer on the front of my statement.
Right, but the whole concept from the beginning is messed up. And I mean, if you look at what the founders set up, it was the best they could come up with what they knew at the time. And I think it's an amazing system. But
and that's what happens is people only do what they know they can do or have been taught. And, you know, you give the analogy of we kept moving west as Americans and, you know, taking land, absorbing it. And what did we do? We created government because we knew that's what we wanted. And why do people, you know, what is one of the top three reasons people come to Alaska?
To get away from government?
And what do they do when they get here?
Make new government.
And make new government. Because that's what they know.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. That's all we've known. That's all we've been taught. And that's part of the reason I don't like public schools, because that's what they indoctrinate into you is government. You have to have it. But I don't think that we do. And
that's where the participatory part comes in is, you know, you need to get people that are like-minded thinking in the government and start participating.
That doesn't work. I mean, we hear that day in and day out. It's always crammed down our throat. I mean, you're getting that crammed down your throat right now on every single program on the radio about Mitt Romney and Obama.
Yeah,
we all know
you.
It's a joke.
But what do? We sit here on the radio after the fact and complain about it.
Yeah, no, we are complaining, no doubt about it. But I don't think maybe we don't know exactly what the answer is, but I think if we got a whole bunch of people that instead of participating, refused to participate, like if only 10% of the people showed up to the election, they couldn't really say that they had, I mean, whenever anyone gets elected, they say, I have the mandate, the people have spoken,
The problem with that ideology is that, you know, it still goes into effect no matter how many or how little vote, it's the majority. The real issue is civil disobedience.
Exactly.
Don't want to pay income taxes, if only 30% of the nation, the Americas, would refuse, you know, the people participating in paying income taxes refused, then something would change.
Yes. I think that's what we're...
But you can't get those kind of numbers anymore. I mean, many groups have tried, the Freedmen's and whatnot, have pointed out, and there's a lot of merit to their arguments and their beliefs.
But they get shot.
You can't get enough people to participate in that.
I think that the only way in America, because we're so sucked into it, My belief is that the only way it can happen is after a financial collapse of the United States government.
Right. Unfortunately, the one out that the founders left us, we don't even see as legitimate for some reason, which boggles my mind because we all love this participatory ideology. But the founders left us the ultimate end-all with the jury. I mean, we could go in and even on the simplest laws, render them useless and basically take them out of effect. And nobody exercises that.
No.
That's true. That would be revolutionary all by itself if we exercised the right of the jury. If every time you went in there, they said no. If it didn't violate another citizen, another person, if it only violated the state and they said nope.
I mean, but to go to this concept to say that,
you know, the problem with the jury portion of that is, you know, originally it was set up of your peers.
Mm-hmm.
What peers were back then in their definition and what peers are today are two different things again.
Right.
Sure, peers were people that knew you, for
yes.
one thing.
Now it's your peer is whoever happens to be an American.
And well, pick yeah, up and whoever the prosecutor and the defender decide on wants on that jury.
Right.
No, I mean, that's also why they move trials to places where they know they're going to get a jury that's more sympathetic to the prosecution.
Yeah, so there, you know, there's problems with that part of the solution, too.
I mean, for instance, do you really think that Senator Ted Stevens would have been convicted here in Alaska?
No.
No.
Unfortunately, no. I think he was as corrupt as the day is long, but he still would not have gotten convicted here. All right, Al, thanks for the call.
Yeah, thank
right,
you. Yeah.
What I'm trying to say, though, is, real quick, Josh, is Al says, well, it took us 200 years to get here. You know, 200 years later, we could get back by the same process. But right out of the gate, we gave Congress the power, unilateral power, to tax us and to create legislative law.
Right.
I'm sorry, you...
It can't work.
I mean, how many times have we talked about how many laws get passed each year? It's not possible.
And as long as people can get into government, can participate in government and get voted in to vote to steal from one person to give to another who puts them in there, it's never going to work because it's all based on theft and stealing. Or that's the same thing. Theft and violence.
I do like the way you said it, though. Theft and stealing, let's emphasize.
So
not only that,
work.
They take stuff from us.
It needs to collapse, and then communities. I mean,
they need to set up their own governments.
Hans Hermann Hoppe says that he thinks, in his personal view, if it would collapse, he didn't actually say it collapsed, but if we had just, if America was a bunch of Hong Kongs, basically, where you had Fairbanks or the North Star Borough, whatever, would be its own little region, its own self-rule. And you wouldn't have to have that building over there. I'd sell that first to somebody. Somebody could actually put use to that piece of junk. And
I could use it for a big bonfire.
Bang. And basically throughout the United States, throughout America, you'd have small factions of people that just traded with each other and did whatever instead of being this ginormous thing that
yeah,
just...
Josh, then the Muslims would invade us and take us over, and so would the Russians.
Yeah, they wouldn't. Anyway,
but what made Hong Kong successful though?
Free market. Who wants to go bomb somebody that's making you a bunch of money?
Do we have the kind of market base here in the Fairbanks area for that to work?
We could. Well, we have mining, which gets restricted nonstop. We've got a huge coal plant down the road that's. I mean, it's huge. There's so much coal there, we could be, like, pumping it all over the world.
Nearly 60% of the people who have jobs...
Work for them.
Work for the government at one level or another in this community.
Yeah.
You're talking about something that would require a complete collapse, where people have no money, have no job, have no prospect. Don't you think that would be accompanied by, I don't know, panic? Violence?
Yeah, absolutely. Ultimately, until people decide that it's wrong to point a gun at your neighbor and steal from him to give to someone else, and that's never going to happen the way we are going right now. It doesn't matter if it took another 1,000 years. Unfortunately, it'll never last another 1,000 years because of the debt. and the fact that the people that produce are going down, the people that steal are going up, and eventually there'll be nothing but stealers.
So just stealing from each other.
We got guy phones. Hot.
Yeah. 458 talk is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Hey, is that me?
It might be. Depends on who it is.
It sounds like it's me. Hey, guys. Hey. Hey, I have an analogy on voting for you that I've been thinking about for a little while.
Go ahead.
So I have a bunch of, or I have two 2-year-olds and a 3-year-old, and, you know, they're at that age where they don't listen to anything that anybody says. And it's really hard to, you know, keep them in line. And, you know, the most common parenting technique that everyone seems to come up with is, you just need to do corporal punishment, you know, and it doesn't work because they just start to get more crazy. But one thing that my wife and I were reading about that these people had was, if you give your kids, you know, a choice between two things, basically two things that you came up with, then it actually seemed to work where they'll choose something. And the irony is both things they choose, or either of their choices, are still things that I came up with that I actually want them to do. And that's what people don't realize, that when you go to the vote, you know, when we go to vote for the president or whatever, or when somebody else goes to vote for the president, you're still voting for two things that the people who are really in power have put in front of you. And so you think that you're doing something that's good by changing the world. Well, we just still have to stay involved in changing the world by going and voting for one of these two things that they've put before us. When the irony is if you actually want to change the world, you have to somehow get into power to where you can get what you want to have happen on the vote. And that is literally impossible.
Right.
And that's not been possible for 100 years now.
What you're saying is that with your kids there, as long as they have two choices, it doesn't matter if both of those choices are ones that they wouldn't choose. As long as they have two choices, once they choose one, they go ahead and go with it because it was their choice.
Right. And what the whole basis of the idea of how that works is that human beings, each and every one of us, have this weird thing that's built into us where we want to have the freedom of choice. We want to make sure that we are the ones choosing what's right for our own lives. And so my kids are duped into thinking that they're in control of their lives when they get to choose between the two choices that I've given them. When the irony is what's really going on is they're just doing exactly what I want them to do. It just, you know, they just get a choice between which things I want them to do. And now what the government's doing is they're using the most fundamental root of that's built in every one of us, that, hey, we all want to live our own lives and want to make our own choices. And so they say, well, here's some choices of what you can have for your government. And we say, yeah, we're going to choose this one, or no, that one's wrong, choose this one. And the irony is both of them put restraints over us that we don't even see, you know, and then we go and then we can ride along with them. And then in addition to that, because we've chosen the choice, we think it's our own choice, and we go forward, you know, just screaming and saying, hey, this is it, this is right, because this is what I chose.
Well, what about if you have three choices, and then one of those choices is a choice for the other choice?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And if you choose anything other than the choice I chose, you chose poorly.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, and then I know somebody's listening to this, and the first thing they're going to do is they're going to call in and they're going to say, oh, yeah, but the whole point is, if you use that analogy, is we need to get in the right position so that we can make choices and put them on the ballot. It's like, guys, you don't understand. The way the system is set up is voting's supposed to be easy. Everyone's supposed to be able to participate in that. But getting to the point to where you can put something forward to a vote is very, very, very impossible in our state of government right now. And that's why, you know, and that's why I know that you guys and myself, we advocate to say, you know what, we're not going to participate anymore. It's kind of like my 3-year-old. He started to figure out, you know what, I'm not going to choose dad because I know that neither one of these things is what I really want. So, you know, so now I have to come up with something else.
Wait, Abe, are you saying there's a difference between the freedom to choose as opposed to self-determination?
Without thinking about it, I would answer yes. But sure.
I would venture to say that your experiment there will probably work all the way until the time that they're about ready to leave.
And then you can kick them out.
Yeah, my wife and I have been talking.
I like that last part.
My wife and I have been talking. One of the things that my problem is, you know, being a dad, is I get angry and I'm like, oh, you're gonna go to your room and you're gonna go do this. And of course, none of my choices that I come up with are very good. And she's way better at it. She'll say something along the lines of, well, would you like to go play in the backyard, or would you like to go do this? And both of them you know, to get them out of her hair. And so the kids love both of her choices. So I think the bottom line for, you know, for my problem is I just got to come up with better choices for them that still, you know, get them to do what I want. So going back to government, that's what they're doing.
But what I was trying to say is, let's say you have, they're all the way up to teenagers, and you give them two choices, and both of them they don't like, and they realize that they don't like both choices, but they actually choose one. They'll feel a lot better about whatever it is they're having to do just because they chose.
Absolutely right. Yep. I totally agree with that.
You know, I don't think the government is learning to give us any better choices, though. I mean, look at, you look at Mitt Romney. How much better is he over John McCain?
They don't need to, though. I mean, you have guys like Glenn Beck come on the radio and flat out say that George Bush was horrible, horrible president. He says Obama's a horrible president. And then he'll sit there and say that Mitt Romney was going to be another horrible president. And it's more important that we be awake under Mitt Romney than it is that we're awake under Obama. Because
right.
He knows the Republicans will fall asleep. So he sits there and says, okay, this guy is crap, but we have to vote him in.
He doesn't anymore. He defends him.
No, he still does. I was listening to him yesterday. He was still saying, just yesterday, he was saying, I'm going to drag my feet when I go to vote. I'm going to drag my feet, but I'm going to do it anyway. They don't need to give us a better choice because they've already given us a much more rotten choice.
Because we're going to do it anyway. So
right.
They give us a choice.
The whole basis of what they've duped us into doing is that freedom of choice thing. Is the voter still believes they're in control, and so they will vote and think, well, you know, this sucks, but at least I'm in control. It's like, well,
and it's that very legitimacy that we lend to it that keeps
exactly.
it running.
And even if your guy wins, are you really in control? Because he'll still vote. He'll still pass laws that are against you, and you don't have, hey, I voted for you. You can't do that to me. No, you're still screwed.
Right, and I think that that's where you guys come with the whole, you know, look, voting lends legitimacy to the government. So we realize that no matter what choice the government gives us, it's not really our choice. We're not going to make a choice. We're going to just stop participating.
No, you are making a choice. Your vote is no.
That's true. That is correct. So the whole point is, we're done with you guys.
Really quick, back to your kids. Once your kid makes the choice and starts to do whatever his choice was, it's a lot harder for him to back out.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, you chose it. That's what you...
Yeah, it is.
I'm not making you do that. You chose that.
Yeah.
If they didn't go legitimize the choice that they just made, then they're accepting the other choice.
Yep, that's exactly right.
And a sad thing about voting, since that's kind of what's come up, is that if you look at history, when you see who first got to vote, it was just very few people when there was this semi-democracy or whatever. The more people have been able to vote and the more people that have gotten the quote-unquote right to vote, the more debt we've had, the more wars we've had, the more taxes we've had, the higher prices things have been. And the larger government has become.
That happened in Rome, though, too. I mean, that happened in Rome. The further the Republic came, the longer it lasted, the more people began to vote themselves money from the treasury, the more overextended they became militarily. It came to the point that all of the politicians were corrupt. The only reason they ran for office was to make a living off of the people's taxes. I mean, we are no different from Rome.
Just a little more advanced.
Abe, thanks very much for the phone call. 458-TALK is the number. You guys ready to take another call? All right. Good morning. Who's this?
This is Bill.
Bill, go ahead.
Hey, let me try and get three things out real quick before we go into conversation. But if you go to Delta, you can live there very cheaply if you had a way to make money there, because there is no taxes, okay? The only thing there is no taxes in Delta. So the only thing you have to pay for is your expenses on the utilities and oil.
Let's clarify. You mean there's no property tax, right?
Right. And then let's see. The thing is about your pool tabs. Your pull tab is that if you was to get a 95% guaranteed 95% payback on your pull tab, you would enjoy the game better because you played longer for the same amount of money. The results would have been the same. So the thing is also is that usually when we went to war, we didn't declare war. We went to, in the defense of others, and then we end up the other pulled out, and we end up staying there trying to win a battle that we didn't begin until we went to Kuwait. And then that was a defense also. It was for a defense of somebody else, and we end up staying there like Vietnam. So my point is this, is that if the borough didn't take so much money out of your pocket so fast, you wouldn't probably whine so, or me also, wouldn't whine so much. If they didn't take it out so much so fast and the playing field of, as far as the pay goes, if the pay was more equal to what I'm doing outside as I am working for the borough, because I get $75,000 and you only get $50,000 without any benefits or any retirement whatsoever, then we wouldn't be so much in complaining. We wouldn't complain it because the playing field would be more equal.
Right. Basically, they're doing a bad job ripping us off.
Exactly. But if they didn't rip us off so much so fast, we'd play the game longer and we'd have more fun, because the whole point is to hope to get that big jackpot at the end.
Right, but like you said with the pull tabs, you basically, the end result is the same. You just get to play longer.
And you knew you was going to lose going in. You knew that from the very beginning.
Yeah.
That you went there in the hopes of winning the big 450 and get that adrenaline rush, because I know I've been there. But the thing is that when I go and play video poker and they guarantee me 95% payback of my $100 bill, it means that I get to sit there and play longer and watch the wheel go around, more. And I end up getting drunk and having fun instead of just hurry up, take my $100, and then I don't get drunk and I ain't fun no more.
All right, brother. Thanks for the call. Appreciate it. All right, 458 talk is the number. Good morning. This is the Saturday morning wake up call. Who's this?
This is Winston.
Winston, what's on your mind today?
I'm kind of disjointed in my thoughts here. But I sort of get bent out of shape about this not voting. Now I live of outside the borough, and I cannot understand why anybody that lived in a borough that would refuse to vote, because follow my thought here for a second. If 20% of the people turn out for an election, and you've got a bond on that on the ballot.
Mm-hmm.
And that 20% decides to tax the whole group of people that are in that borough for the amount of money that's going to be levied against them. If you don't go and vote that bond down, the 20% that are going to benefit from the borough from the bond are going to go vote for it. There's one candidate that you can put on the ballot, and he fits in any race that goes, and that's either Mickey Mouse or none of the above or something other like that. But I think you're going down the wrong pathway with this not participating.
Does it hurt you by us not voting?
Uh, see, all politics is local. Yeah, it does. If freedom-minded people, if we don't do, and I understand the arguments that you're going to have against this.
And I understand. I understand the argument that you're making. You're voting. You're saying you need to vote for self-defense, basically.
Yeah, the self-defense is absolutely what you've got to do. If you don't defend yourself, somebody just walks up and just beats the snot out of you, and you don't raise a hand in defense, maybe you deserve to be whooped.
Well, here's my thought on it. I understand exactly what you're saying.
Right.
In this borough here, in Fairbanks North Star Borough, they have no police powers. I am at the point where I say, screw voting for this or that. Make them enforce something. Like, let's say with this wood stove ban, I'm not going to vote for this new initiative that's coming up. Screw that. I can vote. I can burn whatever I want in my house. I have the right to my own private property to heat my home. If I go down there and vote, and I lose, if that initiative fails and the borough gets to impose a wood smoke ban, however they want to do it, I have agreed that they can do that because I played the craps game and I said, I'm going to vote for this because this is what I want. And I agree that if I lose and more people vote against what I want, then I should, rightfully, you should obey that borough law banning the wood smoke ban. I'm saying I own my property. The borough has no right to tell me what I can or can't do. I'm not going to go down there and beg them and hope that more people beg with me than the opposite beg against me. I'm going to say, do what you will. I'm burning wood. I'm going to have a wood stove. I mean, that's the difference, I think, with this particular borough is we can refuse consent in the voting. Let them vote in all the bonds they want and just say, okay, I'm not paying my property tax. I refuse consent.
But the thing about it is...
takes them 3 years to take it.
But in 3 years, if there's not enough people that are refusing to pay... Most people are just sheep.
No, I agree.
But now, y'all use the analogy of the sheep being outside the fence, and the sheep inside the fence saying to the farmer, come out here and get that sheep back in here.
Isn't that what you're saying to us, Winston? Isn't that what you're saying to us right now?
No.
Hey, we're out of time. We're up against the clock, brother. Thanks for the call. 458-TALK is the number if you'd like to call. Get in queue for the next hour. All right, welcome. Welcome, one and all, to the Patriots Lament radio program right here on KFAR. A program that is made possible by Bighorn Enterprises. In fact, if there were no Bighorn Enterprises, there would be no Patriots Lament, because of course Josh Bennett is the program. Josh from Bighorn, good morning. Also joining us in the studio, we've got one of the other sponsors, or I should say benefactors, that make it possible for this to be on the air. It's Aaron Bennett from Far North Tactical, and I am Steve Floyd, merely the monkey behind the machine. We were just talking during the break how people talk about how this is such a great country because we get to vote. And it's part of what makes us great. We do democracy so well here in America. But you know what? In Iraq, they had elections every year. Before the whole purple finger thing, everybody's like, oh, look, they've got democracy. They had democracy. Saddam Hussein won every year. Of course, there was nobody else on the ballot. But what's the difference? If you have a choice of one or if you have a choice of two, it's like, really?
Yeah, he was able to say that he was legitimate because the people love me. They vote for me every year.
Look, I'm running out of post once again. Nobody's running.
All right, and yeah, I understand that there's only one person on the ballot by design, but that didn't necessarily mean that they wouldn't allow anybody else to run. Was everybody just too scared to run?
I don't think he let anyone else run. But we've only got two.
Right, but not openly. He didn't openly.
Right.
Wait. Like all the people they allow to run here? United States?
No. No, it's not really an open market there because you have two parties that... Why do they call them parties anyways?
Not very fun parties.
Parties are... The two parties rule the system. They give you one of two choices. You can have this choice or this choice. That's all you have. And they're both the same choice. Because no matter which one gets in there, you still have the same government.
I mean, I have yet to have anyone tell me what difference we're going to see under Mitt Romney than what we've had under Barack Obama. Look at all the differences under Obama from...
Mitt Romney's white.
Bush. Well, obviously. And
that's a difference.
Okay.
Would be the only one.
What difference will it make to me and my wife? What did Obama promise us that was drastically different from Bush? He was going to get us out of...
Wars. Afghanistan and Iraq.
We still have troops in Iraq, don't we?
I believe so. We're still fighting in Afghanistan. We ramped it up. We're ramping it up in Pakistan. We overthrew Libya. We're getting ready to go into Syria. We really want to go bomb Iran.
We have got more troops right now in the Persian Gulf ready to go to war with Iran than we had before. Well... than we had actually in the ramp up to the Persian Gulf.
Right.
I mean, we are poised right now for a major war with Iran. It's going to be ugly. And they're doing the same thing to us that they did before Iraq's invasion, talking about how, you know, what a terrible threat Iran is.
I love, what was that, that terrorist attack in, was it Bolivia? No, not Bolivia. Some terrorist attack where they killed a bunch of Israelis a week or so ago. And it was, I thought it was interesting how within, I mean, the first news story I heard on it, oh, terrible, and it was terrible. But then Benjamin Netanyahu comes right out, I know it was Iran, we got to go bomb them. It's like, really? Yeah. False flag, anyone? Nah. Anything that happens, they're going to blame. They want a war. There's no doubt about it. We're going to get us a war. And we're going to go into more debt. And more people are going to get killed.
Here's the part that frightens me a little bit about this one, is that Syria has weapons of mass destruction. Okay, actual, honest to God, nerve gas, poison gas. In fact, the same weapons...
Syria.
The same ones that Iraq had. I did a report in January of 2003, put it on the air, 2 months before we went in against Iraq. People on the ground, actually watching the weapons of mass destruction leaving Iraq... going across the border into Syria. We're talking about major stores of weapons ready, actually weaponized, ready to go, in the weapons themselves, nerve gas, and a bunch of other, you know, nasty chemical weapons. If those are used against Israel, Israel has already promised that they would respond in kind. What weapons of mass destruction does Israel have?
Nukes.
Exactly.
The good ones.
The good ones. You got the good stuff.
The ones that will turn the Middle East into a glass parking lot. If Israel fires nuclear weapons, who else is going to fire nuclear weapons?
Russia.
Yeah. It's gonna get ugly, and it's going to get ugly really fast. And if we have a bunch of nuclear weapons going off, there's something called an EMP that happens just as a natural result of nuclear weapons going off. We're going to lose all of our satellites. I'm going to be out of a job.
I think people like to revert over to EMPs. There's a lot of talk about EMPs going off in America. I think that's just America's way of calming ourselves from not wanting to get nuked. Oh, we'll get EMP'd, and then we'll be knocked back to the Stone Age. Yeah, right. If we have any kind of, any war of any kind, who's going to... It takes sophistication to put something into the stratosphere and let it off. If we get into any kind of nuclear conflict with anybody that has the capability to set off an EMP, they're going to nuke the bejesus out of us. It's not going to be EMPs. Let's just EMP them really bad. EMP is the biggest joke. I mean, I'm not knocking what you said, Steve, but...
Electromagnetic pulse. I'm not talking about an EMP weapon. I'm talking about that as being a result of a nuclear bomb. Even if nuclear weapons went off in the Middle East, we would still likely lose our satellites.
For an EMP to be an actual EMP, it's set off in the stratosphere, though, I thought.
Yeah, if it is designed as an EMP weapon.
Right. But, I mean, but
anywhere they use it, it'll knock all this kind of stuff out.
Like Alex Jones had a guy on talking about EMPs. I believe Glenn Beck did, too. I've heard a couple of talk shows that have these experts come on and talk about what America would be like if there's an EMP. Cut the crap. Anybody that has the sophistication to do an EMP to America... would only be doing it if we were in some kind of shootout, and they're not going to waste their time with that.
And drop it on the ground, baby.
Well, dang right they are.
You know what's interesting and sad? Because we like to steer everything back to the state. Why are all these things happening? Is it because, go out there on the street there and talk to anyone that's walking by and say, are you pissed off with Iran? You think we go kill them all? I'd probably say, yeah, I don't know anyone there. You go to Israel. I mean, it's a fact. The majority of the people in Israel do not want to go to war with Iran. The leaders do. The leaders here in America want to go to a war. The leaders in Iran want to have a war. The leaders in Syria, well, they're getting their butt kicked.
They're already in a war.
Right. But you know that it's not just that civil war, revolution, whatever it's going on right there. That's not just because a bunch of peasants decided to revolt. There's no doubt in my mind that was set up by outside government influences. Russia would like to have war. Probably not the people. You go over there and say, hey, you want to come over and kill a bunch of Americans? I don't know any Americans personally I want to kill, unless it's maybe, you know, a government official or whatever. Wars are fed by the state. The state starts wars. The state encourages wars because states always get bigger when they have wars. They get to tax more. They get to borrow more. And the people go, yay! More war. Everyone rallies around the family with a pocket full of shells, or rallies around the flag. All these things because of a few people in power, like Britain. They want to go to war. Probably not the people there. They're pretty anti-war there, but the government wants to.
Yeah,
and none of them actually are the losers in the whole thing. They benefit. They reap.
The people of England blame America for any conflict they get into. They despise us for all the wars they have to go fight in.
Right, but the government likes them because it doesn't hurt them. They always gain more power because they just take the old cattle, throw you on the car, and send you over, all your kids. I don't think it's right.
Now we're being told that we're not patriotic if we don't voluntarily send our children.
Right, you should actually pay some kind of a fine. Gladly, of course, you should be happy about it, that you didn't sacrifice your child to God's state in a war.
You ready to go to the phones?
Yeah.
458-TALK is the number. Good morning, caller. This is Patriots Lament. Who's this?
Hello?
Hey, who is this?
Hey, good morning. It's Trevor. How you guys?
Trevor, good. What's on your mind?
Let me turn down the radio really quick.
That would be a really good idea.
Feedback there.
I like that echo.
I have a question for Josh and Aaron here, because looking at the shooting with the Joker character here in Colorado, it's kind of the lone gunman scenario that everybody keeps talking about as the reason that we need gun control. And I've just been watching how the media machine is kicking into full gear for gearing up for this UN small arms treaty, and it seems like every other day all we're hearing about is more shootings somewhere in the U.S. And it's like all of a sudden it's okay for them to be reporting this because it suits their agenda. But tying into it is, I remember reading something when I was looking into getting an FFL for my personal collection use, and it says something like when you shut down your FFL license, your records get sent into the government, and then they're kept there basically in limbo forever. So basically the records of any firearm that you have sold is then registered with the government, and they have it anyway. So
okay, the FBI does have a registry. Like everybody worries about that the government has this registry that they register guns into. That does exist to an extent. In all NFA type firearms, all Class 3 silencers, short barrel rifles, all that kind of stuff, that all goes into that registry. Okay, the only time that a regular firearm ends up in that is down the lines of what you're talking about, but that. That's only applicable to this specific type scenario. That would be like, I got an FFL, and that under 10 years time goes by.
On the radio, sorry.
So under 10 years time goes by, if I go out of business, within 10 years of getting that FFL, then I have to turn in all of the paperwork that I accumulate. Okay, so if at year 9 I decide, well, I'm not going to do this FFL thing anymore, all of the records that I've accumulated I do give to the FBI. And yes, regardless of whatever they say, those do end up in a national registry. Most gun stores stay in business a lot longer than that. After 10 years, once my 10-year mark hits, I can take every single record that I have and burn them in a trash barrel. That's a beautiful thing.
So I need to keep you in business for 10 years.
That's exactly right.
Hmm.
So there are places that do just give those things up. I've heard that Walmart and places like that actually send in those things. They just give them up a lot easier.
Sure.
Because if I chose to, I could send all those things in to the National Registry. But the average person that comes in and buys a gun, the only thing that the government knows about that is that you bought a gun. They don't know what you bought. They don't know what caliber it was. They don't know what size it was. If you come in and buy a rifle, it could have been a 50 caliber. It could have been a 20 millimeter Anzio, or it could be a 22 Cricket. They don't know. Nobody gets told. All they know is that so-and-so bought a gun and they were legal to do it.
Unless it's a full auto.
And NICS is like a go-between between the FBI and the gun dealer. NICS isn't taking that information and putting it into a registry. Oh, this guy bought a gun and we're going to put him in the computer and red flag him forever because he got a gun. And so we know where to go get him. That's not how it works.
I think it's... Someone called me. I didn't actually get to the phone, but I listened to his message, and he had an interesting thought. He said, you know, this guy was a med student or something like that, and all this and that.
The shooter in Colorado.
Right. Mm-hmm. And he had over $20,000 in gear and weapons. So he asked, where did he get all that?
The other thing that concerns me about that, besides where he got the gear, was that he was on drugs. I mean, he was... visibly messed up when they picked him up on drugs. And yet nobody's... I mean, if somebody went out and got in a car that was all messed up on drugs and ran into a crowd and killed 12 people with his car...
They'd blame the drug.
They'd blame the drug. They wouldn't be out saying, we need to make sure that there's a national registry for cars. We need to limit what kind of cars you can buy.
You don't know that.
So that nobody can get a car. Nobody needs a car like that. A car like that is designed to kill as many people as they possibly can.
They did say that with the Ford Excursion. That's exactly what they said. I remember when the Ford Excursion came out, they said that car is unfair because it's too big and will kill other people if they hit them. You need to be equal. Both of you get killed.
Yeah, I mean, you guys remember back quite a few years ago, they were taking a registry on anyone that owned a SUV. They were going to ban SUVs.
Yeah. Wasn't he on prescription drugs, though?
Yes.
Psychological, yeah. He wasn't, like, smoking pot or had a beer.
Well, so
he wasn't even on meth, and he wasn't even doing cocaine. He was on prescription drugs. Amazing.
That was the same prescription drug, which... weirdly enough, was the same one that the Joker himself, Heath Ledger, from the Batman movie, died from an overdose.
Overdosed on.
Weird, huh?
Well, it's just, it's interesting.
There are connections here and there.
And it's interesting that, like the caller said, all these things have been pounding on us, boom, 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 the same time the UN gun control ban is up for a vote. Well, it's a treaty, so, yeah. Very interesting. How the media works.
Yeah, I don't think we need to go down the whole road for Alaskans about, obviously, criminals are going to get guns anyway. The only thing we do is disarm good citizens, blah, blah, blah. We don't need that education on this program, I don't think.
What? Why are you whispering? Okay. Why are you talking away from the... You need to talk to the microphone. You've been doing this long enough. You're talking sideways, and I can barely hear you.
Speaking to the mic.
That's right. Step up to the microphone. You're right. I don't really think that we're going to have people coming out and going door to door to take our guns. They might. I mean, it happened in Louisiana, in New Orleans, after Katrina. It did happen. However, I think what's more likely to happen is that people will voluntarily give up their guns. I mean, look right now at how many people are voluntarily giving up their wood stoves.
Hmm.
Did you get one of those notices in the mail? We got a little postcard in the mail offering to give us money.
Oh yeah.
If we would just simply take away, just give up our wood stove, they would give us money.
Yeah.
Well, anybody that says that they wouldn't comply with that has to look back to 1984. That wasn't that long ago.
The book?
No. 1984, when the NFA Act came into a National Firearms Act.
Oh, right.
Which made our guns way more expensive, first of all. Second of all, limited what we could own. I mean...
Wait, who was president back then?
Ronnie.
I thought that the bastions of conservative thought always protected us from things like that.
Funny how that works out, huh?
Go ahead, Aaron. You finish the thought on the firearm ban.
Just, if we allow the government to tell us what kind of firearms that we can own, and we also let them tell us what kind of ammo we own, because under Clinton, they limited nothing out of China could come here for the longest time. Now they're letting those type of things in, but they're very limited. You can only get shotguns and
steel cord.
Right. They took steel cord ammo, became no longer an item that could be imported into America from China. Especially, and they specifically called out 7.62x39. That is no longer allowed to be made armor piercing at all by anybody. So we let them decide on a national level. I mean, I understand California has a trillion gun laws, but on a national level, we let them decide what we can, not only what kind of guns we can own, but what kind of ammo we can own even.
Yeah, people, if they outlaw guns, people would turn them in.
They would. They would voluntarily bring their guns in.
Well, no, I don't agree with you guys. You have to look at...
Not everyone, but people would.
Right. You look at when they outlawed guns in England, and they outlawed guns way more recently in Australia. That's been like 2 or 3 years ago only. The actual guns that got turned in were only about 1%. It's not... Americans aren't... If they outlawed guns today in America, Americans would not go turn them in. But the government wouldn't come get them either. In Nazi Germany...
I don't know. We're a lot more compliant than those other countries are.
Well, in Nazi Germany, they was very compliant people, right? And they made a registry of guns. They recalled guns. Did the people go give them to them?
No.
No, what they did was they made it a crime to have one. So if they did the exact same thing in Australia. Only 1% of the guns actually got turned in. All the people still own them, but they just buried them. Now, that's definitely the American mentality. As long as we have our guns...
We're free.
We're free. So if they outlawed guns here, there wouldn't be a mass turn-in. I totally disagree with you guys. There would be a mass burial.
And they do you a lot of good. They do a lot of good in a box.
Right, as long as you had them.
I think we already have a mass burial. Look at how many places, like that movie theater in Colorado, have a policy of no guns allowed, so people just voluntarily don't bring their guns.
Yeah, they are buried. That's a good point.
No guns allowed at the movie theater, so we're not going to take our gun out tonight. If one person had brought their gun...
Our theater here didn't allow firearms.
Exactly. Our theater here doesn't allow firearms either, just so you know.
You know, it's interesting. That's the government is actually the one that, that encourages you not to carry a sidearm or self-defense, right? Just carry a weapon for your own self-defense. Government encourages that. I don't know why. I guess to legitimize themselves. So if you're not armed, then you need them. Any other, like, just say you had an insurance company or whatever, an insurance type society where they were taking care of your protection, they were guaranteeing your protection, and they had to pay you. Like when government now, when they fail, do they give you a check? Hey, I'm sorry, we failed, you got robbed, you know, instead of you having to pay to throw the guy in jail after he steals from you. You know,
right, their insurance policy is one-sided, definitely.
They should give you a check and be like, yep, we failed. You know, this was our agreement with you, even though you didn't sign it and you don't want it, that we would protect you and blah, blah, blah. So instead of throwing this guy in jail that we caught and making you pay for it, they would give you a check, say, you know, we failed.
Right, if it was an insurance company, they would have to give you restitution if they didn't uphold their contract.
And what would they want you to do?
They would want you to be armed to the tooth because it would bring down their end cost, definitely.
Right. You would be armed to the teeth. In fact, insurance would probably give you, in a part of the policy, like, here's your new Glock 45 or whatever it would be. Aaron would want
right,
a 40.
Part of our,
I want a 40.
Well, if we privatized the personal defense and had insurance companies take over the defense, we would be 500 times more armed than we are now. Definitely, especially if we had free markets, we're able to make money to get that kind of stuff.
And when you got robbed, you would be restituted from either the person that robbed from you or the insurance company. Instead, we have a government that says, you must pay for our protection, mafia. And when it doesn't happen, they just go, oh well, too bad. You need to pay us more money so we can protect you even more.
Very often the victims of the crimes get punished by the government themselves. They turn it into somehow you did something wrong.
Yeah. Well, at the very least, you're paying for it.
Yeah.
At the very least, when the guy goes to jail, you have to pay for him to sit there, which is mind-boggling. You know what else? I was just going to bring up Bloomberg saying that all the police should go on strike until, through legislation, people give up their guns.
I think they should just go on strike and never come back.
All right. Stay with us. We got more Patriots Lament on the way. Welcome back to Patriots Lament right here on KFAR Local Talk Radio. We are streaming live around the world at KFAR660.com.
Hello to all our friends in Russia.
Joining me in the studio, we've got Aaron Bennett from Far North Tactical, and we've got Josh Bennett from Big Horn Enterprises.
I would like to say something real quick.
Really?
Yeah, if there's anybody listening from Colorado, you can go to FarNorthTactical.com and get everything you need to keep that from happening to you.
Nice.
Nice. Exactly.
Gun registries, they're not gun registries, but gun applications, people on the waiting list there went up 41% the day after that happened.
Wow.
I just want to get in on some of that money making.
That's good, though. I'm glad people are. You know what I was saying when Bloomberg, he came out and said, the police should just go on strike. We'll just go on strike until, through legislation, people give up their
They
guns.
Never will, because if they did, people would realize they didn't need them.
Aha, that's exactly what I was going to say. That's exactly right. They'd never go on strike because people would figure out, these guys are worthless. What would people do if you didn't think that you had, and it's all mental anyways, in your mind you thought, I don't have a police to call out, there's no 911, I better get me some guns.
Yeah, and Bloomberg says he has the 7th largest army in the world. That's
he
how
does.
Many law enforcement are there.
The 7th
largest army in the world.
And what's their crime rate there?
The highest in the world.
Right.
You know, that's an interesting point. I keep hearing from people about, the type of weapons he had, the type of guns that the shooter in Colorado used.
I don't even know what he had. I never saw.
they say that nobody should have that except for the military. Doesn't that negate the Second Amendment?
Yeah.
What is the point of the Second Amendment?
To have the same guns the military has. In beta.
To kind of give you an idea, Bloomberg is saying because if people don't give up their guns, the law enforcement themselves isn't going to be safe, right? In 2011, 72 law enforcement nationwide were shot. That's for the whole nation, right? In L.A. County, just the county alone, 54 people were killed that same year by law enforcement, and 22% of those people were unarmed.
Oh, yeah, I got an email about that. It was showing the difference between how many policemen have been shot, which we're not advocating that, of course. We don't want anyone getting shot, compared to how many people have been shot by police.
Ready to go to the phones?
Yeah, sorry, I was reading something.
458-DOG is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Hey, it's Bill again.
All right, Bill, again, what's on your mind?
Hey, look at Zimmerman, and then look at Schaefer. Zimmerman got a defense fund, you know, by a group of people, and was able to bail out, and he's probably going to be able to get a really good attorney. The problem is with Schaefer, I think, is the same way. I mean, his was just words, and he didn't have a defense fund, and he got life in prison. My question to you is, if you came across, if you were like Zimmerman and you had the right to carry and you were to protect yourself with all the stress, with all the, you know, if Zimmerman didn't have a defense fund, he'd probably still be in jail sitting there waiting for trial. Would you do that? I mean, would you put yourself through that? Or I don't think I could. I don't think I would. Because look at the headache, man. I mean, look at the trouble. You'd be, your family would be destroyed. Everything would be destroyed because you used the weapon in defense of yourself. And instead of just getting a broken nose and a bad beating,
There's actually a huge difference between Zimmerman and Schaefer. See, because Zimmerman killed another citizen. He actually killed somebody. He killed a regular guy like himself. See, Schaefer Cox just talked about defending himself from government officials, and he got life in prison. See, his crime was way, way worse.
Well, he hasn't actually been sentenced yet. Let's not send him up the river until
sails. That is right. That's what's looming over his head. He's been pronounced guilty of, 36 charges or something? It's huge.
There's another difference, too, though. I mean, Zimmerman was not arrested and charged by the police until several weeks after the fact when the neighborhood in which rioted, basically, and said, you need to go and get this guy. And so the police actually bowed to the pressure from the public. How do you address that?
I don't think that I would use the gun knowing that I'm going to have to put my family through such a turmoil. You know what I mean? I don't think I'm going to do that. I think I'll take the beating. That's sad, I know. But
no, that's realistic, though. You can get beat and still be alive.
Yep.
And both parties could still be alive when, you know. That's my problem with the whole thing, is that both of them could have been alive, and one of them beat down, and you'd go, there would be a recovery. One, there's no recovery. That's my problem.
All right. Thanks for the call. Appreciate it. Yep. 458 Talk is the number if you'd like to call in and participate on the program through the phone. Aaron, I mean, I know that you carry. I also know that you you work out. And you do the ultimate fighting. I mean, you are not the kind of guy I'd like to meet in the alley and in a dark alley, which, of course, doesn't happen during the summer months, but in the winter, I wouldn't want to go up against you
in a semi-dark alley.
Yeah, exactly. I wouldn't even want to go up against you in a fully lit room. Yeah, you're not easy on the eyes. That's not the issue. The point is, I wouldn't want to challenge somebody like you to a fight for any reason, anywhere, anytime. Do you find that the gun is more of a defense to you, or the fact that you're physically fit?
Because I understand what you're trying to say, I almost don't want to say this, but I actually don't carry a gun.
Ha ha!
You are screwed. I do carry one in my vehicle a lot of times, but working for Josh so much, I end up on base all the time. I actually got in the habit of not even carrying a gun at all, ever. I think it's probably been almost a year since I had a gun on me at all times. I mean, I found myself so many times having to run home really quick and unload my guns to go do whatever task I needed to do, that I've gotten in this habit of not carrying a gun. So I'd have to say that just by default, I would have to go the other way with that one.
Hmm. You know, it's pretty interesting what he was... what was it, Bill?
But to answer your question, I mean, I think I can answer your question from a totally different angle. I'm definitely in a position to be an aggressive type of guy where I could be, quote unquote, the bully, but this is a horrible state to do that in. I'm polite to everybody, not only just because I want to be a decent person, but because everybody I know is armed.
Don't want to get shot.
Right. I mean, if you get into a confrontation here and it escalates, what are the odds that you might get shot?
Pretty good.
Especially if you're the aggressor and give them any reason, you know, the laws here are pretty good for the guy on the defensive side, that's for sure.
Should the law?
It doesn't pay to be a jerk in Alaska.
It's too bad what Bill was saying about getting the beating. It just made me think about that we really do live in an ultimate tyrannical state. You can't rise up against, or even, you have to be really careful. I mean, Schaefer showed that. Careful what you say, what you think, what you do, or you will go to jail or be killed.
Don't say your name when you call radio shows like this one.
I just want to make it easy for the government to keep track of everybody who's listening to the program.
I mean,
just in case they have the tinfoil on the head and, you know, keeps the brainwaves.
Well, you can't say, like, you know, if we came on here every week and said, we need to have a revolution like the one in 1776, an armed uprising against the government to retain our liberty or whatever, you know. You'd go to jail or get shot or raided or something like that for advocating that, which is pretty sad because that's how we came to be. And yet any kind of bad thought towards this government is not allowed. There is no such thing as free speech.
I don't think the government's afraid of an armed revolution. How many people do you know that own tanks?
I don't think they necessarily are, but people would be if they really got after it. I mean, England had ships that we didn't have. They had 10 times more people than we had. We won. I am of the opinion that when you're fighting for your liberty, for your family's liberty and whatever, you win. You're going to win because you got something to lose. They don't.
Wasn't England at war with France at the time?
Yeah. We got into war with France, yeah. France came and helped us.
Right, but they had that knocking on their door at the very minimum.
Well, they'd been in the war with France off and on for
300 years.
Yeah, quite a while. It wasn't like a new thing. Kind of off and on. Kind of like some couples I know.
I'm sure of myself. Were they in a war that day with France?
All right.
We're not a whole lot different now.
4-5-8 talk.
We've been in a constant state of war for basically since World War II.
Yeah. And only we don't need a declaration of war anymore. We just send troops.
Because we're in a constant state. You know, why declare something that we're already in?
4-5-8 talk, the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
I just want to let the government know that my name is Bill. I don't carry, and I'll take the beat down, so don't come after me. I like calling this show, but please don't come after me. I'm sorry if I offended any government official. Right now. Okay, so gosh, you guys, I don't know if I want to call my name anymore.
All right, Bill.
You're just scaring the crap out of me. I'm putting my tinfoil hat on.
That's a really good idea.
We'll have Aaron tone it down a little bit.
All right.
I believe that you're the one that's fear-mongering, Josh.
Trying not to. Right. Actually, I would like people to have a healthy fear of their government. Just not the one that they have right now. A healthy one. Like, a fear of it, like, these guys. A fear to where it turns into anger and a little bit of hatred. Loving to hate the state. Get in there and instead of living in fear like a serf, get off your knees. The fear finally to stand up and say, no more. We're tired of living like serfs. Tired of being afraid to have some jerk knock on my door. Well, forget the knock. Kick the door down and shoot me. That's what we live in right now. I mean, there's that article that Aaron was reading. There's numerous hundreds of cases now where armed state thugs kick in the door, wrong door, and shoot some unarmed person. It's happening over and over and over. And what was pretty interesting was when we had Richard Mayberry on, somebody asked him, when would you decide that it's a good time to leave? And I think one of his answers was, well, if you just saw execution style things going on where police are just, you know, judge, jury, and everything. Well, that's happening. I'd like to ask him that when he comes back on.
Well, another one of the things, I remember actually having a conversation with Schaefer Cox.
Maybe, you talked to Schaefer Cox? Yeah.
It was probably about 6 months before he took that short little train down to Crazy Town.
Dialing 911.
But we were having a conversation, and I asked him specifically, okay, now where would you draw the line? At what point would you say, okay, the government has completely overstepped its bounds, and it is time to act against the government? And he said, when they start setting up random roadblocks.
They is.
Yeah, they is.
They're doing that right down the road in Lagengood.
Random roadblocks.
Yep.
Why?
Stopping everyone coming through. Checking them for drugs, checking them for alcohol, checking them for whatever they feel like.
And do they have a warrant to do that?
Nope.
Do they have a court order to do that?
Nope.
Who's doing it?
No, but they do have the use of force.
They have the state's permission.
Yeah, they
do
got
it.
The state's permission, and they got guns.
Yep. That's happening right now. Happened all this week out in Lavengood.
Yeah, but
state
it's
troopers,
way out there, so.
That's true. And it just affected some people's rights were taken.
Only the ones who had business
right
out there. And if you didn't have any business, you probably shouldn't be on the roads anyway.
Weren't they...
Do you think there's a reason they do it in places like that, Josh?
Yeah, so people don't get upset about it?
Oh.
Get used to the idea. Well, we've been doing this for years.
We've been doing it all over the place. You just haven't seen us. Now you do. Yeah, it's happening right now in Alaska. Right here in good old free Fairbanks.
And why wouldn't we be okay with that? I mean, we're okay with the TSA.
Mm-hmm.
And they're doing Viper deals all over in the lower 48, right?
We voluntarily submit.
What's
every
a Viper deal,
day.
Josh?
Viper, it's a new TSA program where they set up roadside roadblocks and everyone's got to stop and they search your car, they search you, give me your paperwork.
They're not the Airport Security Administration. They're the Transportation Security
right.
Administration. They're taking their name seriously.
And they're doing.
Thank God they are, because there have been so many terror attacks on the road.
Well, there hasn't been because of them, Steve.
Because we knew we were going to create them, the people didn't do it. For 100-plus years of roads? Is that, oh, okay.
Well, they're doing it on subways, railways, bus depots.
I'm starting to think that you both want the terrorists to win. I'm really starting to feel that right now.
They already won. The fact that
you guys
that we,
love brown people or something?
You could actually theorize that they have won.
We gave up?
If it was because they hated us for our freedom... They succeeded there.
We gave up all of our freedom voluntarily.
Right. Yeah. Right. Josh has a good point. You both have a good point. They won. If they hated us for our freedom, like we all claim, because we're free, then they won. They made us not free.
Okay, let's go home. Oh, got 10 minutes.
Well, I mean, okay, so where do we go from here, though? I mean, if we are living in a society, which I believe we are, that the people are not free and they don't want to be free. They have voluntarily given up our freedoms. What is the point of doing this show? I mean, do you really think that we are going to wake somebody up and cause them to act in such a way to exert the freedoms that God gave them?
I can answer that on a personal level.
Do it.
My personal belief is that America, because of the economy and the use of fiat money, so on and so forth, we went down that road enough times. It's impossible for us to not have a collapse. So we're going to have a collapse, right? Everybody, even the biggest Keynesian economist in America says, well, we're going to tank soon. And you have, public services like,
buses?
No, the FEMA. Places like FEMA, okay. I mean, they flat out warning people you need to put aside a little bit of food, this and that. You have in case of an impending collapse, and they come right out and say economic collapse, so on and so forth. There's enough warning signs. Anybody that has any kind of knowledge of, even if you only have knowledge of Keynesian economics, you realize that we're going to have a tank, right? So in the event that happens, Americans, it's not like it was in Back in the first Depression, we don't have 70% of the people employed in agriculture. It's less than 7% of Americans are today. Hey, most people are rural, inner city, so on and so forth, or not rural, suburban, inner city, so on and so forth. If the infrastructure falls, it would be chaotic, right? So my personal goal is to come on to a radio show like this and try and get people to understand what liberty is. And liberty is, the only way you can be free is if the other guy is free. The defining thing of our revolution was people were standing up for each other, not for themselves. That would be the French Revolution. Everybody was out to grab their own. I don't want to see this huge power grab where everybody goes nuts for their side. I want people to pull together and say, hey, there is a better way. There is freedom if we want to have it. So Josh and I come on here and try to define what freedom is. What is freedom? You know, freedom is absence of the state. It's absence of an oppressive monopoly on the use of force, a monopoly on security. There is a better way. And whether I'm even here for it or not, that's not the point. The point is if we do have a collapse of some kind, even if government does get back on its feet, and even if it's 500 times worse than it was, there's still that transition point. A guy was in my store a couple days ago talking about how he has all these different guns, you know, and when stuff hits the fan, he's going to be able to do this and that, you know, and teams, and he's just going off. And I said, unfortunately, the only time that you're ever going to get to use those guns is when you're killing the other roving bands that think just like you do. I mean, that's the only possible scenario that I see happening. So my goal is to keep people from killing each other.
Yeah, we'll be fine. I mean, we could have a collapse and we'd be fine if people would internalize, do everything you said you will do, and don't aggress on another man's property or person.
And yet we see that aggression in every level, even among conservatives.
It's taught
people
by
call themselves.
Right. And we advocate for it ourselves. That's what we're trying to tell everybody, is we are doing this to ourselves. You guys, like two shows ago or three shows ago, I was working, so I just called into the show. You guys were talking about the possibilities of a collapse, and the average caller would call in and say, yeah, but when that happens, we're going to have to set up our own government.
We've
got to find somebody good to lead us.
No, we don't.
No, we don't. And what would be the very first thing, if we put somebody in power over us, what would be the first thing that they would have to do?
Tax.
They would have to
expropriate
from us so they could protect us.
Tax and steal.
They would have
they'd have to take over monopoly of violence and tax immediately. That's what we don't want.
Right, and I think that there is a way better answer to that in the insurance form, but I think we should tackle that some other time when we don't have 5 minutes left.
We got two callers. Let's hit them.
458 Dog is the number. Good morning. Who's this?
Hello?
Hey, who is this?
Hi, it's Cecily.
Hi, Cecily. What's on your mind?
Oh, I was just saying that there's the only freedom is really in your mind, mental. And there's a good movie that'll point that out. Nicolas Cage is in it, and it's called Brazil. It's quite a wonderful movie. It's old, but it'll definitely put a mockery on all the government politics stuff, but it's pretty deep at the same time, and it has a great love story in it. It's called Brazil. And anyway, I hope you enjoy it and check
Thanks.
It out.
Thanks, Cecily. Appreciate the recommendation.
I'm all good with people being free in their mind, or whatever. But I actually want to be free to walk around and move around. I'm not into going to a jail cell with a strap around my body, not being able to move and say, well, I'm free in my mind, so I'm free. There's something, if that happens, where you end up in a concentration camp or something, yeah, it'd probably be good to have that mentality. But that's not what I'm striving for.
You look at Soviet Russia, the vast majority of the people there were free in the sense of what you just said, Josh, as long as they didn't criticize the government.
Right.
If you criticize the government, you got picked up, treated like a mental patient, injected full of drugs, put in a straitjacket, and thrown off in a gulag. Not entirely different what's going on now.
No. And that's not freedom. Freedom is be able to do whatever you want to do with your own property, as long as it doesn't egress on another person's property or person. That's my kind of freedom. And making money.
What else could there be outside of that for freedom? Nothing.
There isn't. That was decided in 1553. And in 1690. And in 1776. Now we're waiting for the next one.
In 1492. Mm-hmm. Oh, never mind.
No. I don't think so.
That was a joke.
What about 1890 with the passage of the Sherman Act?
Did you say the 1200?
Or 1213 or 15? What was it?
1214.
Talking about the Magna Carta?
Yeah.
4 or 5?
In the year 1100, the Charter of Liberties. That was the exact 11 years.
People were stupid back then, Aaron.
Well, they still are.
At least they had a king to tell them what to do.
All those things that we just mentioned all say the exact same thing.
Men ought to be free to own their own property.
Under the basis of common law.
As long as they don't hurt somebody else or harm somebody else's property and do everything that they say they're going to do.
They don't step outside a contract that they've made.
Ready to take the last call?
Yeah.
458 Talk is the number. Good morning. Who's
this? Good morning, gentlemen. Stand fast in the liberty in which Christ has set you free. You sound all defeated.
Oh, heck no.
You guys should start organizing food.
We're just trying to temper it.
Growing food. Food storage is, if you feel that way, start organizing people. Before the system uses a burl to start their programs.
Go ahead. Hang up?
Later.
Yeah. Oh. I don't know. I think that there's a danger in organizing these days. I'm not really about it.
I think there's two dangers. Besides the obvious one that Schaefer Cox gave us a good example of, the other danger is, if let's say that Josh and I organized this community thing and we got all kinds of people involved in it, this and that, and there was a said collapse, who are they going to look to for leadership, and what position does that automatically put me in? A position of power. I'm not interested.
Or target.
Well, I mean, take the target out of it.
Well, you know, it's funny what you said about FEMA encouraging people to store up a few days' food and blah, blah, blah. At the same time, who do they say a terrorist is?
Anybody that stores up food. FEMA will actually sell you everything you need to be prepared.
And then put you on a list. Say, aha, here's the address.
I ordered an insane amount of their survival bars from a little bit ago and sold them out of the store.
Are they any good?
Yeah, they're awesome. They're awesome. I ate them for about 2 weeks to see how they work. Pretty interesting. They definitely do the job.
Is that where that facial tick came from?
No, they weren't bad at all. I mean, it's not like FEMA makes them themselves. They contract them out to about 12 different companies.
Mm-hmm. Yes, terrorists are people who eat food.
Well, terrorists eat food?
No, they just store it.
Powder.
They eat non-government approved food. Just kind of like if you, that was one of the other things, going back to that postcard that we got from the borough and offering us money to get rid of our stove. They also said that we could choose to swap out for a borough-approved device.
I ain't voting on it. I'm burning wood. I hope it doesn't pass.
I hope it does and you burn wood and you go to jail.
No, if it doesn't pass, then the borough
won't. You can't go to jail. There's no police.
They've already
Bingo.
They have already passed an ordinance that gives you a fine if you burn.
Eventually, they will fix that non-police power problem.
They will.
I say everyone's going to vote for that initiative, go down to the borough and have a little rally around there and say, uh-uh, you ain't going to do it. We're not voting on it. We're just telling you no way.
How about everybody rips out their wood stoves, puts them on the lawns out there, and we light them all up at the same time?
How about we go out and burn a bunch of tires and see how they like that air quality?